This is 5 o'clock already. This is 6 minutes past 5 o'clock. So let's get started. Good evening, everybody. It's evening, actually. Nigeria, West African time, 5 o'clock. Good evening.
Hello.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for tuning in. It's after this, you can know who tuned in, actually, because we just have cameras all set here. We're trying to do some recording here as well to make sure that those who don't get to watch it live now or listen to it live now can always actually come back and watch it later on our social media platforms. Good evening, everybody. I'm Dami Adeyemi Vites.
Yeah, my name is Oyin Oyinloluwa. It's good to be here.
Yeah, actually, it's very good
to be
here.
Weird.
Oyinloluwa, Oyinloluwa, you have a son name now. Please,
Jesus,
bear my son name.
Oyinloluwa
Jesus. Jesus, cool.
It's Oyinloluwa Jesus.
All right, this is Mrs. Oyinloluwa Adeyemi Vites. Thank you very much for tuning in.
Yeah.
We appreciate your coming around. And for those who are going to be watching this on YouTube later or on Instagram later or listening to it on mixler.com/Adeyemi Vites later, thank you very much for tuning in. God bless you.
Amen.
We believe that you believe something is going to come out of this. We believe that you know that there's a level of content that this will actually bring to you. And we're grateful to God to be a blessing to the body of Christ in this capacity. I want us to just say a short word of prayer and then we can start the whole process. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you because we know that today is a great day. Wisdom will be shared. Eyes will be opened. Lives will be transformed.
Amen.
Thank you because there will be depth communicated today.
Amen.
There will be life communicated today. Even
Amen.
Those who are not believers will come to the brightness of the light of Christ in us.
Amen.
And life will actually be made available unto them in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, we thank you because your words are common grace and power.
Amen.
And we will speak according to what your plan is for today and not what we even think or we have imagined or we have even planned. Your spirit will take absolute control.
Amen.
And your name alone will be glorified in the name
Amen.
Of Jesus. Father, we thank you for answered prayers. In Jesus' name, we have prayed.
Amen.
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 Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so let's get started.
Yep.
Yeah. So, babe, how do you feel?
Good. closed. It's nice to be on the side. Usually, you know, I'm behind the scenes.
Yeah. She's always behind the scenes, but this year she's going to be on the scene, man.
Amen.
A lot, and amen. I'm so excited about that because she's loaded. Actually, she's very loaded. she's very deep. That's the word. thank you for let me use the word gracing the occasion with your presence. It's well appreciated. I'm actually blushing here because of this woman. Can you just imagine? All right, so let's get started. Candid questions to ask your spouse before you get married. And then for those who are married who are also watching this video, know fully well that even when you get married, there are still questions you have to answer. There are still questions that will be asked. There are questions that life will still ask you. But if you answer all the questions that we're going to be discussing in this series, it's going to be a series. We're not going to just finish it today. We can't finish it today. In fact, let me bust your brain a little bit. We have over 300 questions that we have prepared. Over 300 questions. We don't even know how we're going to end the series, but we've tried to see how we can make it four Saturdays. But today we are actually going to be laying very solid foundation for this very crucial topic. A lot of things are happening out there, a whole lot. In fact, sometimes when we're gisting in bed, she will just show me some things on Instagram, and I was just wondering, like, how did people get here? How did they get into this mess? If there were questions asked, they would have been able to know that, okay, this is trouble, avoid it, don't get married to this person, it's going to hurt you, or something of that nature. But because questions are not rightly asked, they run into trouble. But let my wife just shed a little bit of light on this, then we kickstart the whole process. So, baby, shoot.
Let my wife.
Yeah, shoot.
Yeah, basically, questions that we need to ask, or people that intend to get married, it's like, it's two faces or it's two sides, you know. There's the side of people that want to begin a relationship, and there's the side of those that are in a relationship and want to get married.
Exactly.
So basically, is this going to be questions for those who are already, they've established, they've crossed some paths? Like, there's some things that I expected that would have sorted, exactly. That would have been sorted, like things like purpose questions, like, do we have the same belief systems?
Yeah,
those are not the questions, but
those
these are like
basic
things
that
have to
be
sorted out first
before, like, you even start asking these questions.
Exactly. Yeah. So, I think that asking questions actually is what makes marriage easy, you know. It makes, you know, there's a saying that the first year of marriage is usually the hardest year or the most difficult year. And I believe that's because a lot of people don't ask some questions before they get into the marriage. So when they enter marriage, they now life hits them, and then begin to see differences in ideas and beliefs and opinions and things like this are what shape
the
marriage.
And even plans for their life.
Exactly. Like, people are genuinely shocked. But ideally, if you answer these questions and you genuinely, sincerely, like, go through the questions that you should ask, I believe first year of marriage is like honeymoon.
It's
the time when you guys don't have any distractions, like any, no child, no,
yeah.
no, nobody coming
no
to you know, to disturb your life, you know.
Yeah.
So it's asking these questions, I believe, is like the bedrock for a sane marriage, like an ideal marriage, a marriage where, you know, both of you want to make it work, want to get it right, and nobody is compromising or nobody is losing for someone else to win.
Yeah,
basically.
Exactly. So she has rightly divided the word of truth there. The first thing is tackling belief systems, purpose questions. Before you start asking candid questions about the person you want to get married to, or about the things you both will have to believe in or work out when you want to get married, there are certain things that have to be developed or sorted out first of all.
Yeah.
Like she rightly said, you have to take care of basic things. Like, you, at the point when you're asking these candid questions, you're not in doubt of the person you're going to get married to.
Yeah.
You're not afraid to ask these questions. Trust has been developed. You're not going to be wondering if this person is going to answer your questions or not, or if this person is forming or not, or if this person just wants to say what you want to hear. So let me start with the first foundation for a relationship before you start even asking questions at all. Trust is built over time. Trust is earned. Trust is not just bequeathed on somebody just like that without the person earning it. You have to earn it. So you can't, because if I ask you questions, if we are dating or not married and we're dating and I'm asking you certain questions and I'm saying, sorry, how many children do you want to have? And you are bombarding me with questions the first day, or I'm bombarding you questions the first date. I'm going to freak out, like, what's wrong with this person? I mean, this is the first date. We've not even built trust. You know, I can't tell you some things about myself so fast. And I've not established trust with you. I've not even known you as a person enough to say I want to marry you, and you're bombarding me with questions. This is where some believers actually make mistakes. You put the cart before the horse. Like, you have to actually take processes one step at a time.
Yeah.
You can't start asking these candid questions we're going to teach if you have not established trust, if you have not established clarity of purpose in the relationship, the purpose of the person aligning with yours, the person's assignment about life aligning with yours, the person's belief system aligning with yours. You must have gone past all those levels. And you know that, okay, even if you don't ask too many questions, you are safe in a sense when you say you want to get married to this person. Then you will not start asking the candid questions when trust has been developed. Let me tell you a very simple truth. If you get involved with a smart person who is smart intellectually, emotionally, spiritually, and everything, that person can swindle you with answers. The person can actually just read you up, and the person can actually just look at you and say, okay, this is the answer that this person would like to hear.
What you want to hear.
And then you're asking the question, the person is just giving it to you.
Back to back.
We actually have seen that kind of marriage as in life, very close to us.
Yeah.
The woman was so naive, she was so... oh, this person is a pastor's son. He's everything that a woman should want in a man. And she just let down her guard. She didn't ask too many questions. She didn't face reality. And then even the few questions she asked, he answered her the way she would like to hear her husband to be answered. And then he got all the questions right, except very close to the wedding, when maybe like a day or two, when he now started telling her, see, hope you know, say I don't say sorry to anybody. Imagine that. And you've been in a relationship with him for how many years?
For 8 years. And you've been saying sorry for 8 years, you know.
And you've been saying sorry for 8 years.
I must add that this is where the Holy Spirit comes in. You know, as a child of God, many people want the Holy Spirit to tell you, is this the one? Is this not the one?
Yeah.
Is this the one for me?
Yeah.
I believe that the Holy Spirit, what we should ask the Holy Spirit is like to be able to have discerning spirit, like to be able to discern more, to be able to know when one is lying, to be able to see beyond the physical,
see the words,
another thing that I must say is that in addition to asking the Holy Spirit to guide you, to show you the true state of this person's heart, to show you the mind of this person towards you, another thing I must add is that when you're asking questions, or even some questions don't need to be asked, or some questions don't need verbal answers.
Exactly.
There's some questions that you would already know the answer to by how you see this person act with other people. It doesn't have to be when you're there. It can be what someone said he did, or it can be anything. Like, you have to, because if the truth is, the story he gave, if we're going to analyze objectively, they were signs.
She didn't pick them.
But she didn't pick them because she was just listening to what he was saying.
Exactly.
And she chose to believe blindly.
Or she was hearing what she wanted to hear.
Exactly. She didn't ask the Holy Spirit for any help.
Yeah.
She didn't seek counsel. It was just, oh, this is what he says, and I love him. And
that's just
he's
what
a pastor's son. Pastor's son is scam people.
Serious scam
so,
everywhere.
So basically, the Holy Spirit is your...
It's your compass.
It will guide you to all truth.
Exactly.
Like, I believe that as a child of God, like, if God is your Father and you have the Holy Spirit, you cannot open your eyes and make a mistake.
Yeah.
It sounds like a proud statement. But to be sincere, you cannot be God's child. God, there'll be signs, even if it's at the last minute.
Exactly.
God will find a way to make you see. It will be you that would know that, okay, I saw the signs, the Holy Spirit revealed to me, and I chose to go ahead with it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So trust, and then being led by the Spirit of God will help you to even know, even when the person is lying or the person is not answering the questions correctly, you'll be able to put you through. So we've talked about trust, and trust is built over time, like I said earlier. I've talked about the leading of the Holy Spirit, even when the person is answering the question, but you are showing your spirit that this person is not answering this question correctly, sometimes intentionally, and sometimes some people don't even know what they are saying. Let me even say that there are some questions that some people will ask you, so you will ask some people when you're about to get married. They have been sincere in answering those questions, but they don't know what they are saying. Let me give you a classic example. So if they asked me 4 years ago when I was about to get married to my wife asked me that, how is it going
to
be?
You're not about to get married.
I was already married. Okay, I was already married. Sorry, 4 years ago. Sorry. Not 5 years ago. 4 years plus now. We got married December 2016 now. This is January 2021. That's 4 years, 1 month. In fact, it's 4 years, 1 month yesterday.
Oh, okay. Hey, but right? 4 years ago, you're
okay. Okay, it's an approximation. Yeah, like 4+ years ago, before I got married, she was asking me certain questions about where I'm going to be today. I might not actually be able to give her the exact position I am in right now. I just know I was going to be a great guy. I'm going somewhere to happen. And I just invited her on the journey. Mm-hmm. But the truth is, if she asked me when we're going to leave in 4 years' time, or how our life is going to be like right now, I won't have been able to say the exact answer. All right, but I think most important thing is, just like she said, having the Holy Spirit as your compass and as your guide will help you. Now, I don't want to sound spooky for the benefit of those who are probably not born again, who don't hear God speak to them, so that it won't be like, oh, it's just about Holy Spirit. The questions we are going to teach you how to ask are questions that over time, when you are sincere in asking those questions and you actually pray sincerely in your heart that God should help you in getting the answers, God will actually open your eyes to see them.
Yes.
When I met her, she just knew I was a great guy. She didn't imagine this physically happening to us. I can say boldly that I'm sure in her imagination, she just knows that we're going to go great places.
My imagination is
the imaginations were high, I understand, but like there's a difference between the imaginations you had then and the reality we're facing right now. Like the reality is much more than what we expected. God actually is exceeding our expectations. You understand what I'm trying to say? So it's how do I put it now? Some answers might not come directly to you like that. So don't go all spooky, all pushy, trying to get answers from people. In fact, another dimension to these questions asking and answering is that you might not even have to verbally ask them, like she said. You might not have to verbally ask a lot of questions. In fact, I had a lot of questions in my heart when I met her, and I answered a lot of them even before I met her. That's being observant, being sensitive to see information without even asking the person for information. So let me give you practical examples. I knew I was going to do ministry. I knew I was not going to be a church goer and just sit down and listen in church and go home. I knew there was something big about my life to do when it comes to the assignment God has given to me. It wasn't even really clear then if it was going to be family systems or not, but I just knew there was something big God wants to do with my life. Could have been in the prophetic, could have been in teaching, could have been anything. I knew I was like a totipotent cell then, and I needed to make sure I get married right. There were shoulda, woulda, couldas, plenty, plenty, like my wife always called them, like plenty shoulda, woulda, couldas that could have been my wife today. But I knew that if I didn't get it right, I'm going to run into trouble. So I had questions in my heart that I must ask whoever I'm going to get married, but maybe not ask her directly, but I'm going to be observant enough to actually check those questions and be sure that they are answered. So the first time I actually set my eyes on her, she was... She was a bloody fellowship bus driver. So it was a honorable service, but a bloody fellowship bus driver. Come on, that's what you were then. Well, don't get me wrong, I'm just
kidding.
Like she was a bus driver in fellowship, and the first thing that caught my attention was, why would a girl this young be so committed to driving a fellowship bus? Like, what's going on? Like fellowship boss, of all things that a young girl in medical school should be looking at, she's looking at driving a fellowship bus. I'll see her carrying speakers, doing all sorts of stuff. It was actually quite strange, and that first person that caught my attention, like, okay, one question answered. Looks like this person likes working for God. Okay, yeah, I know when I marry her, she's not going to be carrying speakers for me, but that very substance of being available for God caught my attention. One question answered. I didn't have to ask her. I just noticed her around. That's one. And the day it dawned on me I was going to marry her, she also came to do ministry. She came to Cold Room in Medilag as that at Luth. And then she came to give somebody, she came to give exam brethren to one of her pastors.
Pastor Debo.
Yeah, Pastor Debo Adeole. Yeah. So she came there, she dropped the exam brethren, gave him all the things that he prepared for the pastor in terms of like, okay, our pastor is writing exams, let's take care of him, that kind of stuff. And then she left. That caught my attention to like, ah, welfareism, okay, that makes sense. So she's answering my question, ticking my boxes about what questions I have as regards the kind of person I'm going to get married to. Then again, it now dawned on me when she now banged the door, came back, and apologized to everybody where we were reading that. Sorry, I banged the door on you guys. And I was like, oh my God, I just melted. I'm sorry. That's how I got my revelation. You like, okay, there's something deep in this sister. I was like, oh deep God, that kind of stuff. So that's just an example. I didn't have to move close to her. In fact, when I collected a BB pin, then BB used to be the other day, I collected a BB pin. I didn't chat her for like months. I didn't chat her. But I would just be jamming her at front of YMYM at Luth. She would come and buy something for maybe fellowship stuff for her mom. I would go there and buy something for my pastor. And that's how my answers were getting to be answered. I mean, my questions were getting answered gradually. Like, I didn't have to even meet her to ask. And then I was watching her on BB. You know, people write status on BB. They put pictures on BB. I watched her for months, how she was changing her BB pictures. How her status was changing, what she was writing, just to sample the contents. And then the first day we had a talk, December 24th, 2013, I can't forget. We talked from like 12 noon to like 12 midnight that day, non-stop. The only thing that just changed was maybe she just wants to get something done for her mom. And that's the first time ever we ever talked on phone. Yeah. And before that time, we don't used to talk physically. And then a lot of questions were answered on the spot that day, and I just knew that okay, this is it. Easily, because
you knew
I am now. That brings me to what I want to say. Before you start asking people candid questions, there's some level of intimacy that you must have reached. There are some levels of intimacy you shouldn't reach before you get married, and that is physical intimacy. But every other kind of intimacy is allowed. Like emotional intimacy, spiritual intimacy, intellectual intimacy,
emotional.
I've mentioned it earlier. I said emotional, spiritual, intellectual intimacy. Yeah. Those three kinds of intimacy, you should actually be able to ascertain that this person can give it to you, or you can actually feel it that okay, you have that level of intimacy for you to have questions answered very well. Because sometimes when the person is answering your question, the person might not even know what he is saying, but because there's a spiritual level of intimacy you've developed over time, you can even excuse some unavailability of certain answers that the person might not have for you at that point in time. Alright, so physical intimacy is the only one you shouldn't get involved in before you get married, but every other kind of intimacy you should. I am sapiosexual in nature. I am highly intellectual when it comes to conversations, and we had very serious intellectual conversations that day. Very intellectual, highly spiritual, and she was just—I mean, she was just—I was like ping pong, that kind of stuff. As I was giving it to her back, she was just giving it back to me. I'm like, oh, and then I'm not. What if
playing?
That's the point. You couldn't have been playing me because I have sampled you. I mean, I went back to do research. I'm a research girl. I did a lot of research on you, man. So I know you're not playing me. I know, in fact, your personality was such that you're not that kind of person that would actually, I'd have been, I'll be wasting time
nice, exactly.
And trying to be nice to somebody. You were not even this nice then. God has saved your life. I mean, yeah.
No. I wanted it to be like. I was going to make sure that I put out whatever it is that is like my possible worst.
Yeah, so you
that
did actually.
Married, it will get better.
Oh my goodness. She showed me Pepe. That's another story for another. Don't let's distract ourselves. That's another. As in, she showed me Pepe. But all those things actually pointed to the fact that, yeah, we can have very candid conversations.
Yes.
We can have candid questions asked and answered. And she asked me very candid questions.
Oh, I did.
And she did. She put me on the grill, man. I was grilled very well. Like, she did a very thorough job. Me, I didn't have much questions to ask when I got to meet her because I had answered all my questions in my heart. Pure flower, okay, yeah, that's true. Ododo, Kontofelo, Janley, our mommy and daddy. I had a lot of my questions answered. Now, that's another thing about asking questions. You see, as much as I don't want to sound spooky, I have to be very real. There were some things she didn't even know about herself that I had as questions in my heart then that the Holy Spirit revealed to me.
Yeah.
And it solved a lot of problems, even before we got talking. Even when we started talking and I started seeing the manifestations of some of the things that the
Spirit... manifestation looks...
Okay, I am FM people, sorry. Not manifestation, sorry. But like outward appearances of some of the things that the Holy Spirit had told me about her.
Yeah.
And she started showing them. And it was very clear that, okay, this is what the Holy Spirit was trying to say. So it was easy for me to answer those questions even before asking. And so I had less questions to ask. But they actually had a lot of questions. She put me on the grill. I answered questions from my pastors. In fact, before I married her, that's part of what I was trying to say the other time, that I've done my assignment. I went to meet our pastors without even asking her out yet, without even talking to her. I had gone to meet our pastors and I had made
that
my intentions
known.
Yeah, annoying, but that's the right thing to do. You were under the tutelage of some people. I understand that now. It's not so, I mean, like, in retrospect, I could have just come to you directly, but I just felt that was the right thing to do at that point in time. Number one, you're writing exams. I didn't want to distract you. I was just this handsome guy that doesn't want to distract this fine babe. Let her finish her exams first. So I chose not to come and meet you directly. We were talking. You were even asking me questions, if you remember, like, what do you want? And I said, in set time, I'm going to tell you what I want. But I mean, you're not a baby not to know what a man wants, as serious looking as I was then, coming to you and spending time at Loot and be leaving Loot at other hours and all that. And I wasn't leaving Loot at other hours because we're not that close then.
Yeah.
But I mean, me hanging around you at Loot all the time, and then you just keep asking the same questions. What do you want? What's this all about? And I kept telling you, in due season I'll tell you. And the reason is because I didn't want to, at the set time, that's what I used to use, at the set time I'm going to ask you what I want to ask you. And then, I mean, you knew now. Ati Faraso, Ati Fojuso, Ati Fimuso. Ah, Ati Fenu, sometime. Sorry, let me speak English. As in, we've used all our whole bodies to talk, all our body parts to talk to you. Our nose, our mouth. No, not mouth yet. Our eyes. Every part of our body was telling you, I say, babe, we like you. We just don't want to tell you here because we need to program it very well. That kind of stuff. So, some of those questions were already answered, but she asked me a lot of questions and it actually helped her to understand me because I was just coming from nowhere. She had a lot of other people that were on her case then, but I mean, I'm a star guy. I'm just joking.
No comment.
All right, so she had a lot of people coming around then and she had to ask all those questions. They were very deep questions. We're going to share some of them in the course of talking.
All of them.
A lot of them, actually.
Yes.
We have over 300 questions to share, and without much ado, we've laid solid foundation. So let's get started. So what is the first question, babe? What's the first question that when you have crossed
lines,
this line of, okay, you know purpose is aligned,
yes. belief systems
are not clashing. You know that this person, most likely you're going to get married to this person, but there are certain things that are yet to be
so
asked.
Make your marriage easier. Maybe. Like, you're not, this is not knowing, is this the one? This
or
is
not.
Just, yes,
that's
this, is, this is to make it smoother, to make it easy, to make it not a problematic marriage.
Yeah, exactly.
Not to know who the one. So the first question that is the basic question that you guys already know you want to get married, you know your belief systems align, your purposes align, you guys are going the same way, blah 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 blah. The first question is,
should it
why
be?
Marriage?
Yeah.
Why marriage? Like if you don't understand the real reason why you want to get married, then the truth is, in the future, when in the marriage, there might be some issues.
And the purpose
if,
is not
if
known,
you're,
you abuse it.
Exactly. If the reason why you want to get married is because of someone to cook for you, to have sex with you, to be your companion, to have intellectual conversations with, to be your friend, all those things can be gotten outside of marriage. Like, okay, of course, the Bible says, you, according to the Bible, you shouldn't have sex with anyone until you're married to the person. But other than that, it's called fornication. But other than sex, like, all these things can be gotten without getting married. And there are
people
that don't believe.
People are even getting sex now.
Exactly. There are people that don't believe in or don't believe fornication is a sin.
Yeah.
Or don't, no, they believe it's a sin, but don't believe that it's possible not to fornicate. Exactly.
That's the word.
Some people say, oh, I know it's a sin, but how can I do it? So, some people fornicate. So if all the if the reasons why you want to get married is
can be gotten outside marriage, why get married?
Yes, why marriage?
So let me take it up from there. So let me expatiate on what she just started. So you want to get married, and this person is actually asking you why marriage. The answer is very simple. Why marriage is a valid question to ask, but the answer actually lies in the motive.
Yeah.
Why you want to get married. So you can get a lot of things, like she said, outside of marriage. You can get that intellectual intimacy. You know, in fact, I'm going to do another series on cheating with time when the Holy Spirit permits me to. Yeah, because that thing is deep, very deep. You see, that cheating word is not ordinary. That cheating is not just sexual. Having sex with somebody outside marriage or cheating on somebody outside the walls of your relationship is like the Z of the matter. There is A to Y.
Yes, a lot of things have happened.
A lot of things have happened before you start having sex. I mean, yeah, a lot of things. Even down to men that go to brothels to have sex with sex workers. Something has happened with A to Y before that Z happened, and you say it's cheating on you. There's a lot about cheating that is going on out there. And I think everything boils down to certain levels of intimacy that people are actually missing out on.
Yeah.
Intellectual intimacy. Some women are married to their husbands or their wives. Yeah, some people now, because now women marry to women now in these days. So we have to actually address that. That's another topic for another day. We'll talk about it before they ban us from Instagram. The day we open our own channel, we will talk. We'll talk, don't worry, very soon. All right, so I mean, people have intellectual intimacy with people that are not their husbands or wives. You can be married to a man or married to a woman, and you're actually having intellectual intimacy with somebody else. And this intimacy is very deep. Nothing more, just intellectual intimacy. You guys discuss a lot of things, politics, career, finance.
It starts from when you get home, you want to discuss some issues with your husband, your spouse, your husband or your wife, and the person, you start with A, and the person is saying 1, 2, 3. Like, after some time, there's a connection, and then you now find somebody outside.
So if you now get married and you lock yourself in marriage, in quotes, and in marriage, ideally you should actually not be looking out for anything else.
You should have all the levels of intimacy in your spouse.
Exactly. But now, people want to get married and they're not asking themselves, will I get this level of intimacy with this person I want to get married? So why this person? Why marriage? If I seek intellectual intimacy, like I am a sapiosexual person, if I seek intellectual intimacy with somebody else and I wasn't married then to her, and that's all I wanted in a woman, I would actually get it free of charge. I didn't need to get married to her. I could have actually looked for all those my friends that were intellectually sound and just have intellectual conversations.
In fact, there was one woman
I ran after for like 5 years because of this thing that we're talking about. Just intellectual intimacy. This girl at 19 had 2 master's degree. By 21, 22, she already had a PhD. I think by now she would have like 3 PhDs ever, whatever it is. She's that intellectual and all that. And why are you looking at me like that? So if I wanted intellectual intimacy and that's all I wanted, I would keep my friendship with her and that would just be it. If I wanted emotional intimacy, there are people who could have given me emotional intimacy. There are friends that will actually chat, talk.
Even family members
can give you some level of emotional intimacy.
Yeah.
Spiritual intimacy. There are plenty. Pastors. Church members are like your prayer warriors. Anything happen, you guys can actually mingle and gist and pray about that matter and spiritual things. In fact, there are friends, if you check your life, there are friends you have like that. They give you spiritual intimacy, but maybe not intellectual intimacy. So you spend some time with them for a spiritual intimacy. There are some people that you spend intellectual intimacy time with. There are people you spend emotional intimacy time with. And then for those who are not born again, who are listening, which we are still going to address with time, some people actually get the physical intimacy they want from people. We have actually witnessed people wanting to get married, and they were still going out to somebody on a date, and they were still sleeping with somebody else. They were going to get married. In fact, we saw something on Instagram recently, and you go, "Oh, shoot me!" Like, are you kidding me? Like, she actually was saying, they are going to get married now, but the guy was with somebody else.
Yeah.
And the guy was actually
He said it was in a serious relationship.
And now she's like this, she was the side chick, but now she's the main chick. That's what it is, like take
she's
over.
Even, like, preaching, like, oh, even
she's even preaching to people on Instagram, like if you are the side chick, have hope, like anything can stay up. I'm like, oh my god. But the reality is there must have been a level of sexual intimacy that she the man enjoyed with her. Or at least some level of other levels of intimacy, maybe not physical, can be emotional, can be anything. For a man to leave a woman for somebody else, there's a level of intimacy that went in.
Yeah.
Flip it, same thing. For a woman to leave a man, there's a level of intimacy she's enjoying with somebody else. So if you know you can get all these levels of intimacy outside marriage,
why married?
Why do you want to get married? So you have to ask that person, because this is a very intellectual route it just took you now.
Yes, it might not be
that person might not even have an answer for you.
Yes.
But ask.
Yes.
Ask that
eventually,
first question.
The person will have an answer.
And then check it out. Sometimes the person might not have verbal answers to give you, but actions will speak louder than the voice that they are coming out with.
Yeah.
You will know if the person is getting married because, number one, pastor is saying he must get married. You know there are some roles in church. If you don't get married,
you can't be a pastor.
For instance, in some churches.
Or like that's the next step. Culturally, like, you go to school, you have a job, you get married, you leave your father's house.
Yeah, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So some people get married for different reasons, and you need to actually be sure why the person is getting married. Like you need to be clear why the person is choosing to get married.
Yes.
Now there are quite a number of people who are desperate out there. And you need to just be careful. Some people are just desperate to get married. They don't even want to know the purpose of marriage. They just believe that tradition, culture,
like
social environment has pressured them. They are 30, 31, 32, and they are young ladies. They feel they are not in lele, like they are getting old and they are not looking. They are not looking young anymore. So they compromise that state of being ready for marriage. And I say, see, anyhow, man that just comes.
Yeah.
Let's just do it.
A lot of people have equated fulfillment to marriage. Like
exactly,
there's a form of fulfillment that marriage gives you, but that's if you're wired for it and if you understand the purpose. Like the truth is, if you're not fulfilled as a single person, marriage will not fulfill you.
Exactly.
And a lot of people believe that if you're not married, like you're not, like there's something missing in your life. Like there's something wrong with
it's
your
societal
life.
Societal pressure, environmental pressure.
If you're given to be able to stay without getting married, it's even better.
Exactly.
According to the Bible.
In fact, if you read your Bible very well, you are better off not being married.
Yes, because
we are married for 4 years now. We know there are times some don't tell us like
Now wow,
which can't see me this
now, wow.
Not that we're not enjoying each other's company, but there are times when you just feel like, I just want to do my day, Jerry.
Can't I just do my day? There are times I come back from work,
and
because of the whole coronavirus, our son hasn't been able to go to school
since March last year.
So there are times I come back from work and I hide.
Yeah, I mean, she in
like,
fact,
I
let me gist you. There was one day she came in from work last week, and I had to hide my wife. Like she went to hide in the bedroom, put up the lights, and she had to lay on the floor beside the bed. The bed is big enough for her to for you to not know that somebody is there. So she was laying beside the bed. Because my son, once he knows his mom is around, there is no more play. It is just himself and his mom. I want my mommy. He will drop his tab, give everything. I am even surprised that he has not come to disturb us till now.
Yeah.
In fact, I was freaking out at the beginning of it because he came downstairs and was just saying, oh, my tab, oh, my this. We had to set it up for him. I said, see, go to your room and stop disturbing us. Go upstairs and just enjoy yourself. But the reality is, that is one thing marriage is going to come with. You just want to be on your own at some point. Like, I just don't want this cry. This boy is crying. I'm frustrated. I just need space. Sometimes I lock myself in my office upstairs and I just say, see, nobody disturbs me today. But I lie. It's cry alone. I'm distracted. No matter the meeting I'm having, I am distracted. Those things make me feel like, sometimes I'll be I married to
Sometimes, like, I feel like, maybe if it was just us, like we would be.
Yeah, if it was us, we would born understand each other well, but a child is involved.
Exactly, and the truth is, children happen.
Yeah, children happen, man. In fact, we used to pray for twins. But now, thank God, twins do not come because I have a take to her.
So marriage is not a like something you tick off.
It's not a
stage of life. It's not so, like you go to primary school, you go to secondary school, you get married. No, it's not
exactly.
Like that.
So you have to ascertain why that person is getting married to you.
Yes.
If you find out that the purpose why the person is getting married is a weird purpose, you have to just get the purpose straight first. Because the truth is, when you get married and you find out that this person just got married because he needed to tick a box, he's not going to get some inheritance from his father if he's not married. There are some guys like that. They just want to get married because people will not stop disturbing them. Their mom will not stop disturbing them. They don't get married.
Yeah,
or their friends, so that they can feel among their friends. Like, me too, I have a wife, so that the wife can be like a trophy that they're going to put on the wall.
So that she can cook.
So that she can cook. In fact, I've had very ridiculous stuff. Like, the reason why some people marry is because they need...
I
don't like eating outside. I like home food. My mom is old. She can't be cooking for me again. My sisters have gone to school or they've gotten married. And I need a woman in my life. And that's all he's thinking about. Ask, or you'll be surprised. That's what some men are thinking about.
Ask
the woman, why are you getting married? Is it because I have money? Or what exactly are you thinking about?
See,
because some women get married because they want
to rest.
They don't want to work again. They don't want to have any sense of responsibility for themselves.
Yes.
Like, the man is responsible for them.
No,
and that's the purpose why they are getting married. So ask, why are you getting married? That's 1A. That's question 1A.
Yes. The truth is, they're like,
okay, let's deal with it.
They're like, how many billion people on the planet?
Yeah. And 7 billion plus.
So whatever it is that is your, you have to also be sincere with yourself. Whatever it is that is your preference, is your reason, there will be someone, there will be at least one person in this world that is close to you that would fit into it. So you need to be sincere, and you and your partner need to be sincere in your answering these questions.
Yeah.
You can't afford to not be sincere with yourselves and say, oh, we love each other, we want to be with each other. Love is never enough. Love is beautiful, yes, but love is never enough. You guys have to open your eyes and answer these questions so that
it's very important.
Exactly. So the B part of the question is the same, is that the same question, but
the B part is now, why me?
Yeah.
Why you want to get married is the first question.
Yeah.
That's 1A. 1B is now, why me? Why me of all the people on the surface of the earth? Why are you choosing to get married to me?
Because God said.
See, don't let me say something right now. See, I have been in religious folds for a long time. I can say my age. I'm not afraid of it.
Oh shit.
I'm going to be 36 next April. And I have spent the first 19 years of my life in a very religious circle. I'm not going to mention the name of the church. If they are watching, they know themselves already. In a very religious circle. And I can see how people over spiritualize things and use the word God said. In fact, me too, when I got to med school, I still told one babe, God said you're my wife. See, that thing. That's God said thing. If I have my way, I would rather say, God has to speak to you.
Yes, definitely.
God has to be involved in every
God's
aspect of your life.
Child, definitely.
God, there is wisdom to direct.
Yes. No, it's a story for another day.
Yeah, that's a story for another day. There's wisdom to direct. It's a topic for another day. We're going to deal with it. But I've even dealt with it before. If you can go back to some of God should say. But that God should say should just be more or less like, go, I've given you victory. But it doesn't mean that go ahead, he's coming.
Ignore, please.
He's coming. Hey.
Continue.
He's coming. Yeah, here. Petra, daddy and mommy. Is he busy or are busy now?
Daddy and mommy
are busy. Don't touch it! Please, we're recording. Yeah, say hi to them. Say hi to everybody.
Hi, everybody.
Bye.
Yeah, say bye.
Bye.
Oh yeah, go back to your room. Go upstairs. Go and watch your tab. Say bye bye.
Bye.
I love you, Petra. All right.
Go outside.
Yeah, go upstairs. Daddy's busy. Don't distract daddy and mommy. Thank you.
Sorry,
please. We just have to just do this or else he won't leave here. You almost stopped the recording we're doing right now, sir. All right, so what we're saying, What was I saying?
You were talking about God said.
Yeah, so the God said part. Yeah, I've seen it spoil a lot of lives before. I know what I'm saying. I've seen it ruin a lot of relationships before. Don't marry somebody because somebody asked you. I mean, don't marry somebody because you asked the person, why me? And the person said, because God said you're my wife. Or God said you're my husband. That is just nonsense. As serious as it can be, the person truly can hear from God.
Yes.
But that is
person
just nonsense.
Hear from God, but that should not be the only reason.
That should not be the reason. That should not be the only reason why the person is getting married to you.
That can be the main reason.
Yeah.
But that should not be the only reason.
Yeah, because
that should not even be the main reason.
It shouldn't be. Like, it shouldn't be the main reason why somebody is Petra, please, you're distracting us big time. You're distracting us. You know what? Daddy is going to come and carry you and jump and play outside now, okay? All right, go back to your room upstairs and enjoy watching your tab. All right? Okay. Are you a good boy? Are you a good boy? I'll give Daddy 5. Come on, give Daddy 5. Good boy. I'll move upstairs. Good boy. Daddy's busy, okay? Good boy. Thank you. Bye. I love you. About what I'm saying. So if I was not married now, there will be no distraction. I'll be talking freely. But it's part of the puzzle. Paul has said it. Anyone who wants to get married should just be ready to get the cross because it's not beans. Alright, so let's just continue. So it's very important that you don't let somebody swindle you with that God said. God said is not the reason why somebody should get married to you. So that person should get married to you because that person has an understanding of this truth I'm about to share with you. Number one, the person has an understanding that you are not the only person on the surface of the earth. Like my wife said, there are over 7 billion people on the surface of the earth that he or she could have gotten married to.
Yeah.
And it would be foolish of you to say, God said you're my wife or you're my husband and that is why I am marrying you.
That's the only reason.
No, it shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. There must be a set of reasons. Number one, you know, you have an understanding at the back of your mind that there are 7 billion plus people on the surface of the earth and you could have married just anybody else. That's number one. Number two, you know fully well that even when you get married to this person, there will still be people who look like shoulda, woulda, couldas that could have like, I could have married this person.
Yes.
I should have married this person. I would have married this person.
Yeah.
But babe, you're married. Dude, you're married.
Even before you marry,
you have to get to see people like.
You would always meet someone.
And you always meet people like that.
Definitely.
You always meet people like that. My wife, sometimes when she comes to my office and sees some people, she'll say, guy, I've been in your spec. I say, yes, I'm my spec. But the truth is, I'm married. There's nothing I can do about it again. I mean,
it's too late.
The
door's been closed.
I mean, the door's closed. I have just one person. But it's a foolish thing to be told that you are the only person that I could have gotten married on the surface of the earth and that's why I'm getting married to you.
Yeah.
That's a foolish thing. Let the person be able to tell you that the reason why I'm marrying you is not because I can't find somebody else who would have been like you, but I choose you. That's the right answer. I choose you. I choose to marry you. No matter what happens, even if I see any other person that looks like you, that dresses like you, that looks as beautiful as you, and has all the qualities like
mild.
You.
That's mild.
Okay.
If I see someone that looks better than you,
that's the word.
Better than you.
I'm still sticking to you. Like, I understand what marriage is all about, and I am sticking to you because marriage is a commitment.
Yeah.
So that is why that first question, if you check, they go hand in hand. One A and one B. Sorry, one A, not one A. Sorry, because they are going to abuse me after this video now. That I have Yoruba accent. One A, not hey. So one A and one B, they go pari passu. Like, it's pretty clear that you have to first of all understand why the person is getting married. And when you understand why the person is getting married, you now ask the second question, why you? So the person should be able to tell you exactly why it is you. Should be able to ascertain the fact that I understand I can meet somebody else that could have been like you or that is better than you, but I'm going to stick with you because I understand what marriage is all about. I am not in marriage because of what I want to just get, but what I can actually give to you. So that's the first question, 1A and 1B. I think the second question that actually should be like a front burner is should actually be related to purpose and belief systems, how they align. Like, so there are certain questions you have to ask as regards that. Don't forget, you said that initially you must have perceived, or at least to a large extent, know that
got
you, yeah, you cross that point that you know that okay, purpose wise I don't think our purpose will clash. Like
you still
you still need to ask. That's where that question comes in. Yeah. But like I did, I didn't ask you if you're going to be a ministry person or not.
You eventually did.
But I did after I initially. You know, we're talking about initial. You saw the person. You have weighed it in your mind, even when you are moving close to the person. That purpose wise, you don't think you would clash. Assignment wise, you don't think you would clash. But when you now are in the relationship proper and marriage is being discussed,
yes,
you have to ask purpose related questions, assignment related questions.
Assume.
You just have to ask. Let me tell you one of the questions my wife asked me, and I can't forget, or that we talked about, and it got to a point that we needed to actually have that question answered. And it is, if God says today, Yemi Levites, drop your job full time, stop working, just face ministry. Although now we have a better understanding about that, but as at that time, the level of understanding we had was that God can actually tell you, drop your work, drop ministry. Drop your secular war, no job at all, just face ministry squarely. And I used to say it then. In fact, one lady told me, point blank, say, I can't marry you just because of that. Forget it. In fact, I don't think there's anything like full-time ministry in my dictionary. There's nothing like that. So if you are thinking full-time ministry, Zegobe, bye-bye, we are not doing. And that was it. I have been heartbroken a couple of times, but this woman came around. Oh my goodness. She came, she mended my broken heart. Praise the Lord.
Sewing machine.
Spiritual sewing machine. All right, yeah. The purpose question has to come.
Has to.
You have to ask the person questions like, what's your life all about? Like, forget all the paparazzi, forget what people know you. There's a difference between personality and assignment. You might fall in love with somebody's personality and only find out that the assignment of that person is very much different from the personality you fell in love with.
Yes.
So beyond the personality that attracted you to this person, that brought you close to this person, you have to be able to ask that question. Like, what's your life all about? What's your purpose all about? Some days ago, we still talked about this thing that we're talking about now. Before we got married, we asked each other that question.
Yeah.
And then we brought it up again, like, babe, we asked ourselves this question and this was your answer. Some life issues have happened, things have happened that looked like they were going to distract us and all that, but we were able to realign ourselves because it's pretty clear that those were the basis of us getting married. Like, there's a purpose why we're coming together to get married, to fulfill God's mandate on the earth, not just to have children, have sex, have fun and all that,
or procreate. Be our companion.
Yeah, you can get all those things outside marriage.
Yes,
you can.
There was a bigger picture.
Yeah, so there was a bigger picture. And then, so that question that we answered that time helped us to be able to realign ourselves again on certain decisions we're supposed to make and all that.
Yeah.
So you have to ask the person very serious questions. What's your life all about? What if you're not going to be paid for something? I'm not being paid for this I'm doing right now, but I can do this till thy kingdom come. I don't have to be paid for it.
Yeah.
In fact, recently, it dawned on me that the works of my hands that I do as career is just to feed my family. It's just to make sure that I live a comfortable life. It's just to make sure that I don't suffer this woman. You can see how pretty she looks. I don't suffer her. I don't suffer my children. I make sure everything is fine and well. But that is not the core purpose of my life. And if she met me then and she met me as a career man and she thinks that's all about me, then she would have missed it. So I had to tell her what my core is. All right, my core is what I'm just doing with you right now. My core is being a light to the world in different capacity. You're not paying me for this. People organize master class for this kind of stuff and collect money. I'm doing it for free. People will know me very well. This is my core area. This is my ministry. I can sit down with you morning till night and we're talking about relationships and marriage. We're talking about kingdom matters, ministry. You don't have to even pay me 10 kobo to do it. All right, so and that is my core. So ask that person, what's your core? I asked my wife, what's her core? She's a physiotherapist. I'm a healthcare finance professional. Thank God I got it right. Praise the Lord. Because she's always abusing me.
No.
You're always abusing me when I don't get it right. It's because of camera, I try to deny. Is it truth?
No, that's not why I laugh. Yeah, why did you laugh?
Say why you laugh.
Because I thought you were going to say something else.
That's what I'm saying.
See,
So I'm a healthcare finance professional. She's a physiotherapist. But that is like our vocation. That's like our job. Yeah. That's what we do to make money. So what somebody does to make money is different from what somebody does to fulfill purpose and be a blessing to humanity. They are two different things.
Very true.
And you must not mix it up when you are
some
cutting
people have
somebody.
Their vocation and their assignment as
the same thing. Yeah. So for instance, we can actually flow into this and say over time, maybe when you put videos on YouTube, you start earning money.
Exactly.
You can say, okay, I'm not doing secular job again. I'm not doing my vocation again.
Yeah,
I just
want
focus
to
on this. And I'm giving my full content.
Yes,
I'm being an evangelist in this regard. I'm still making money from it, but it's feeding my family. It's taking care of basic needs I have. But you must not mix that thing up when you meet somebody and you're going to get married to the person. You must be able to ask, what's your core? The peripheral is the vocation, the vocational skills the person has, and this person has can actually help put food on the table, earn money, make you guys live a better life, travel around the world, buy a house, buy cars, do whatever you want to do with your lives. But that person's core might not actually be addressed yet. And so you have to ask that person very deep questions. What's your life all about? If they don't pay you for anything, what do you like doing? That even if they don't pay you for it, you'll be happy to do it. That if they wake you up right now, you've not slept in 3 days, and they just wake you up and say, yeah, come and do this thing, you'll be very passionate about doing it. You'll be so happy to do it without anybody paying you for it, and you do it so graciously. God has graced you so much in that thing, and you're able to do it easily. Let me tell you what will happen when that person answers this question sincerely. Number one, the person will be happy that you are interested in the very core of his or her life. The person will be happy because that is the core of marriage. Marriage is about building a synergistic adventure together. To say, you can do this thing, I can do it too. If we come together, one will chase 1,000, two will chase 10,000. When that person knows that you are asking this question because you are interested in that person getting better with his or her purpose, it actually helps.
It helps.
So that question has to be answered. But I think you see, you have some things to say about this purpose thing and assignments. We discussed some things, yes, no?
I'm
in your mind. I don't know, we have one spirit now.
Yeah, I think you've said it all, basically.
Okay.
Basically, I just wanted us to not look like everything is
spooky.
Yes,
spiritual.
Spooky or spiritual. So basically, we only touched two questions today, and we talked about the reasons why you need to ask those questions. That was what we really spent time on today.
Yeah.
The reason why you need to ask those questions. Who needs to be asking these questions?
Yeah.
You know, those are the not everybody should be asking these questions. Like I think you mentioned that at the beginning. You can't just
wake up and start asking people randomly.
That's not the reason why you should marry somebody.
Yeah,
if it's someone you already plan to marry, that you should ask these questions. And I think subsequently in coming weeks we would also talk about the other questions. We won't dwell so much like we did
on the
before.
So next, we'll be going into
the questions.
Is it only next week or next 2 weeks? Should we do it weekly?
I work on Saturdays, but it depends. Let's see how it goes.
So we should still keep it for next week.
Next time.
We'll decide that. We'll let you know when the next one is going to be.
Yeah.
But it's going to be for 4 Saturdays. We're going to talk about it. So the next one, like she said, will now be very, very fast.
Yeah,
we'll talk about different aspects of life, belief system, spirituality, finance,
children, religion,
political views, culture.
What is going to be the culture of your home? Different. Like the questions are inexhaustible.
Yeah,
there are
inexhaustive,
so many. And
actually,
some questions you look like, oh wow, I never thought about this. Why will you ask this? You know, some people say when you ask some things. Let me give an example. It sounds like, shut up, God forbid, don't ask that kind of question.
Very good question.
The example of, I'm trying to give you guys insight into what we're going to be talking about. Like, oh, what if we don't have children?
We ask ourselves.
Like, what if children don't come?
Like, we've seen people get married, nothing's wrong with them, they didn't have children. So,
what if children don't come?
It's
God's will
if you go to churches where my wife, where I went to pick my wife for instance,
churches
like the one that my wife actually was picked from. I'm not going to say no the church, but those who know, know. Yeah, like as in, if you go to those kind of churches, some people from those kind of churches might find it very hard to
answer that. Why are you praying for that? No, that's not it.
But life happens. Things happen to people.
Life happens.
And we prayed about it that it's not going to happen to us.
Yes, thank God we have children.
That we have gone past that level.
We have children.
Yeah, we have children now. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
So we it was actually a question that I asked him, like, what if? Because, you know, in course of our discussion planning marriage, he already said, oh, I want to have so number of children. I want a this, I want a that, I want a this, I want a that. I'm like, okay, that's beautiful, guy. But what if?
So you have to answer this question.
Yes.
There are some questions that might not be so pleasant to ask.
Might leave you guys, you just say bye-bye and you leave.
Yeah, but you have
but
to ask
you have to answer.
They are like acid tests
answer,
that you have to put to your relationship. Yeah, for instance, another question that might come up, we're still going to deal with it, are questions that have to do with maybe family patterns or family history. Is anybody in your family that has run mad before? That's not a pleasant question to ask. That's why you shouldn't ask that kind of question with somebody that you don't have some level of emotional intimacy with and trust. Like, how many people have run mad in your family before? How many people have had history of stillbirth in your family before?
Yeah.
How many people have had a history of maybe drug abuse in your family before? All those kind of things you have to ask, because some of these things that actually can be genetic, depending on.
Yes.
So you have to ask all these questions and probably prepare your mind for.
Yes.
You have to prepare your mind for the worst.
Yes, but you're opening your mind to your realities, like your entering with your eyes wide open. You guys are entering as a team, and you know that you're calling on. It can even mean that you know things that you need to pray about before you even get married. Like, you guys will settle it before you get married.
Exactly.
But it's good to have your eyes open than to go in and then marriage. That's when you see people say, "Oh, after 3 months, they are getting divorced."
Like,
I believe they did not answer some questions.
Yeah,
it can even be things as simple as, oh, do you walk around the house with your slippers that can cause people to
how
do you press toothpaste?
Slippers in the house.
It sounds mundane, but these are things that
are real questions.
So the questions that we ask, they would go from serious or basic to very serious to questions that your parents must not hear you ask, because they will do deliverance for you. But basically, we just want everyone to get it right. We want everyone around us to get it right. To get it right. Because the truth is, ideal marriages exist. Like, we have people around us that are enjoying their marriages.
Yeah.
Like, the idea that
doesn't mean they don't have issues, they don't fight,
or they don't have disagreements. They're human. But your disagreements are not grave. They are not.
There
it's
are
nothing
things like
serious.
I'm breaking each other's head.
You understand?
Or you're backing out of each other's house.
Or you're saying, I'm going to leave your
house. I'm going to leave your house.
These are things that if you prepare, it's just like how the richest man in the world today is not a Christian. So being a Christian doesn't guarantee that you would have a good marriage.
Exactly.
You have to prepare for it.
You
have to work. There are things that have to be put in place to ensure that you have a good marriage, that you have a good home, that you are successful in life. And so this is just us trying to bring to you the questions that we believe would
So we'll deal with those questions. So back in your questions, we'll just pick them up by one next week and we'll start tracking them. All right, thank you very much, guys, for tuning in. If you have questions, you can actually just send your questions to my email box, adeyemilevites@gmail.com. Adeyemilevites is ADEYEMILEVITES. Don't forget to put the S, because we're a nation, so we're plenty. adeyemilevites@gmail.com. Is that not what I sold to you? I sold it to you live. You bought it. Our nation. Come and be the mother of this nation. I agree. So adeyemilevites@gmail.com. You can also DM me on Instagram, adeyemilevites.